The Bible tells me there is never, no, not at all, any condemnation, any sentencing, any punishment to those who are in Christ Jesus. And you know what? He's not capricious. God is not fickle. God is not changing. God is not like, has mood swings. Oh, sometimes he loves me so he doesn't whack me. But sometimes he's not happy with me, he whacks me. I do not know how to relate to a God like that because I'm not sure whether he loves me or not. No. God loves us eternally in Christ Jesus. You are pardoned forever. You are forgiven for the rest of eternity. No, never, not at all, any condemnation. Martin Lloyd-Jones, a preacher who has just gone on to be with the Lord, said to be preacher par excellence. He had this to say about this verse. There are many who misunderstand this. They seem to think of the Christian as a man who, if he confesses his sin and asks for forgiveness, is forgiven. At that moment, he is not under condemnation. But then, if he should sin again, he is back once more under condemnation. Then he repents and confesses his sin again and asks for pardon and he is cleansed once more. So, to them, the Christian is a man who is constantly passing from one state to the other, back and forth, condemned, not condemned. Now that, according to the Apostle, is a wholly mistaken notion and a complete failure to understand the position. The Christian is a man who can never be condemned. He can never come into a state of condemnation again. No condemnation. The apostle is not talking about his experience, but about his position, his standing, his state. He's in a position in which, being already justified, he can never again come under condemnation. That is the meaning of this word, no. It means never. So, think about this. Paul is saying there is therefore now no condemnation. This is where I think clarification needs to come in. Some of us think, oh, very good, like that. No condemnation. Then can I do whatever I want. I can go sin whatever however I wish, and it's okay because not condemned. Now let's be clear about scriptural teaching. Let me, if there's a word, deconfuse. Let me clarify that apparent confusion in our minds. When God says there is no condemnation, it doesn't mean that there is no more sin, all right? It doesn't mean, first of all, that there is no conflict. When I preached the message on struggle within, there are some who are concerned because they say, how can we still be struggling with sin when God says we are no more condemned? Now, scripture is very clear, very precise. God uses the word katakrima. There is no judgment, there is no punishment, but it doesn't mean that there is no conflict. In fact, I think this verse in Romans 8 verse 1 comes even more precious and relevant to us when we understand Romans 7. Romans 7 tells us of a titanic struggle within every Christian. The new nature versus the old flesh in us. And we sin. And there are times we are weak, we fall. We fail, we make mistakes. But even as we make such sins and mistakes in our lives, you know what? The Bible says there is no condemnation to you. None. Yes, you were struggling. Yes, you failed. And yes, you said, Lord, this is the 374th time. But the message of heaven says, no condemnation, son. It is when the battle is hottest that this verse comes forth alive greatest. I think that's why Paul says it again in Romans 8:1, because I think the issue could have been settled already in Romans 5, where God says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have what? Peace with God. We have irene with God. We are one with God. There is no more condemnation. Actually, already stated in Romans 5:1. But he's got to say it again because Christians struggle with sin, and when they fail, they feel condemned. And Paul has to remind them of scriptural teaching. There is no condemnation. You may fall. You may sin. You will have mistakes in your life. But God, our Heavenly Father, says, not condemned. Not seen to be guilty in your position. Not going to be punished judicially for your sins. So, number one, no, it doesn't mean there is no conflict. There will still be. And in the light of such conflict, the release from condemnation is especially sweet. But number two, when God says there is no condemnation, it doesn't mean there is no correction. Ah, this is where clarity of thinking has to come. It doesn't mean today that God allows us to sin and we do whatever we want and he's not going to deal with our lives. No, he will. He will. But he doesn't do it because he is an angry judge. He does it because he's a loving father. It's not punishment, it's chastisement. It's different. The motivation and the purpose of it is totally opposite. Punishment is to pour out his wrath that your sins deserve. Chastisement is about the love of God to turn you from the destructiveness of sin. That's the difference, you see. And there are churches, there are people, there are teachers today who say, oh, there is no condemnation, so you can go and sin whatever you want, and God is not going to change or correct you. Nonsense. God will. In fact, if he doesn't do that, he doesn't love you at all. Which parent here does not discipline your child? If you don't do it, I say you're a lousy parent. Really, lousy. Because you don't love your child. You look with me in Hebrews 12, if you may, if you will. Hebrews 12, and this is a great text, because we often confuse hurt and harm. Now, I hurt my son regularly. I do. My wife and I, we hurt our son regularly. We whack his backside. We cane him and he cries, buckets. And our hearts are so pained. Can I stop caning you? Cannot! I got to cane you because I love you. Now I hurt my son. But I never intend to harm my son. He needs to learn because I love him. And God needs to hurt us in order to spare us from the harm of sin, you see. In Hebrews 12, it says here, you have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son. My son. Not my enemy, huh? My son. Despise not thou the chastening of the Lord. God is going to chasten you, but he chastens you as a father to a son. He says again in verse 6, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. When the Bible says no condemnation, does it mean no correction? No. You're not condemned, but you'll be corrected because he loves you. And that correction can be very strong. The word that is used later on in Hebrews 12 verse 6 is the word scourge. You know what scourge? Whip, flog, pienta, pia. God can use scourging in your life. But he's not condemning you. You see, that's the difference. He's correcting you, not condemning you. He doesn't hate you. He loves you. You've got to get that very distinction clear. If you endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. Hey, realize it's about dealing with you as a son. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if you are without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye, the word in the King James is bastards. Which means illegitimate children and not sons. A proof of your sonship, a proof of your relationship with God is the chastening hand of God. But the motivation for those pains in your life is not punishment. It's correction. Frankly, if God really punishes us for our sins, I don't think we can even stand. Because I think the punishment our sins deserve is gigantic. I think it's like $10,000 billion kind of thing. Cannot be numbered. Why? Because the sin is not against an ordinary man. The sin is against an infinite God. And if we are really to pay the penalty, we would not even stand. So when God deals with us, He's not punishing us for our sins. The sins of the world will be punished forever and ever and ever in the lake of fire. But when God deals with us, He deals with us as children, as His child. And therefore, no condemnation, but there is correction. Thirdly, to clarify the myth, or to demystify this whole understanding. No condemnation also doesn't mean that there is no crisis. You say, so good to be no condemnation, so my life will be a bed of roses. No, not at all. You see, again, this dilemma arises because we confuse hurt and harm. Crises are painful. Let's face it. When you lose a child, when you're stricken with an incurable disease, when you just lose your job, when ministry collapses and fails, those experiences are painful. They hurt. But they're not intended to harm you. It's not because God is angry with you. It's not because God wants to tekan you or whack you. There will be crisis. Romans 5 tells us we can rejoice in tribulation, in the crushing experiences of life. God says those are good for you. Count it all joy when you fall into diverse testings or temptations. Because God is molding, shaping, growing your character. So again, churches take a verse like Romans 8:1 and they say, well, now that you're a Christian, no more sins. Perfectionism, lie. They tell you, number two, God is not going to deal with your sins. No chastisement anymore. No bad things will happen to your life. Again, lie. Because they confuse hurt and harm. And there are people who say, when you are in Christ, no condemnation means there will never be a crisis or trial that God gives. Again, nonsense. Doesn't square up with Scripture, you see. Finally, no condemnation also doesn't mean there is no consequences to your sin. After the first service, one of our members asked me, Pastor, what do you mean by that? You didn't say a lot, so let me say more. No consequences is some thinking people have. Because God doesn't condemn us, so I can sin whatever I want and there will be no consequences. No. The Bible tells us that when we sin, we will reap its natural consequences. We will. I mean, Galatians 6, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that he shall also reap. If he sow to the flesh, he will of the flesh reap corruption, decay, dying. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death. The word wages there is the word opsonia. It's not the salary you collect at the end of the month or the end of the year. It's a daily ration that is meted out to you so that you can carry on being a soldier. And when you sin, sin pays you something right there, right then. It pays you opsonia, which is death. Something in you dies. The consequence of sin is something in your soul dies a little every time you sin. The principle of sowing and reaping is not violated when God says there is no condemnation, you see. If you choose to visit prostitutes and you contract STDs, God is not going to remove it for you. If you are in adulterous relationships and your family it breaks up, that's the natural consequence of sin. No, it doesn't mean that God doesn't love you, all right? It doesn't mean God doesn't love you. His love is like the sun still shining bright, but you have chosen to be under the shelter away from the sun of His love. He still loves you, but you have made a wrong choice. And for that, you are going to suffer the consequences of your sin.